I told him, I'm the old experienced guy. I said, the only thing worse than being between you guys and ice cream is to be between you guys and happy hour. So, and I've done both of those, or all those. I got some things here. We're not going to be able to cover everything we do at Dakota Lakes in a very short period of time, but it's really all about water. If you think of a farmer, what he's trying to do is take sunlight, water, and carbon dioxide and turn them into products he can sell, period. And how efficiently we use the water. And for, you know, there's a lot of young people here, but 30 years ago, this area was winter wheat, summer fall. And we didn't have the grain bins, and we didn't have the wealth that we have right now in central South Dakota. And the difference between then and now is we're doing a better job of using water. And so we're going to focus a lot on that today. This first handout, and there's more than what you need because some of you guys are sneaking out, leaving us. But that first handout really deals with plant water relations. And it's quite complex. And we spend a lot of time listening to the meteorologists say, well, boy, is it going to rain? We need to have rain. But if the water doesn't go in the ground when it does rain, it doesn't do you a dang bit of good. We used to get the same amount of rain as we get now, but we're just using it better because in the old days it ran off. In the old days we thought we needed to have irrigation to make central South Dakota productive. In fact, they used to think they had to take water from Waukee Reservoir over to Redfield to irrigate the Jim River Valley so they could grow corn. And a lot of you young guys don't know that, but there's a canal located not very far north of here where they were going to actually do that and cover up the city of Blount and take water over to the Jim River Valley so they could irrigate that. And I almost didn't get my PhD because in my thesis defense or in my final orals, I made the statement that I thought we could very successfully grow corn and soybeans in Jim River Valley if we quit doing tillage. And we didn't need the irrigation project. And one of the guys on my committee, of course, had spent his career working on that irrigation project. So it wasn't very smart. of me to say that, but so you have some physical characteristics of the soil, and you heard Jason Miller talk about that, and Jason's done a lot of work here. soil compaction, soil texture you can't do anything about, but soil structure you can. We're going to show you that today. And one of the problems we have, like in the corn belt, or we had here when we did summer fallow and things, is we took soils that held 8 or 10 inches of water, and then with tillage and time and compaction and the wrong rotation, we turned them into soils that held 6. So now what happens is when you get a big rainfall, you become overly wet too soon. And you get lots of runoff and flooding and that kind of stuff because the soil doesn't hold as much water as it did in the old days. And you can look at any gauging station you want to, and that's true. And then on reverse side is once it turns dry, you don't have as big a bucket when you started and you get drier sooner. And so what we're trying to do here is to build our capacity to hold water, get the water going in the soil, keep the water from evaporating once it's in the soil, all these little things we're doing. And then by having the macropores and things we're going to show you to allow that plant to explore that soil and get all the water out of it, but it can't do that if it has a diseased root because it has bad rotation, or it can't do that if it gets plant diseases because it has a bad rotation, and it can't do that if you do something stupid, right? So that's really what this talk's about, not a major thing. I'm getting rid of last year's rotational thing. This has all the records up through 2011 at Dakota Lakes Research Farm on our dry land fields. We've done the same or similar rotations on the dry land portion of this farm. And we've had lots of rotation studies other places and whatever, but the dry land portion of this particular site, we've had very similar rotations that have gone on for 20 some years. And you can look at what's happened to those up through 2011. The reason I'm getting rid of those is because we had them left over. See, in 2012, you heard Nathan talk about the good wheat yields, and we had excellent wheat yields, and we had excellent pea yields and flax and those kind of things, and the corn pretty well was a zero. Not quite, but almost. And the sorghum was pretty good, so the drought-tolerant corn was quite a bit better, and he talked about that as well. And then the big thing is this thing we're not going to read necessarily, but it's an emphasis on rotation. It talks why we use crop rotations, and it talks about different types of crop rotations. And I'll just summarize those real briefly, but crop rotation is much more important when you quit doing tillage. It's the diversity that controls, and you all got to watch Otta, and you got to listen to Emmanuel and Bob, and they all talked about these things, and you didn't see a lot of weeds out there. And we don't spend lots of money on herbicides. You know, we might spend on just under 1,000 acres, we might spend somewhere between $6,000 and $8,000 a year on all of our pesticides. It's not a major part of what we do. We spend a lot of money on fertilizer because we sell a lot of products. But we try to control, we see technology, and technology is a great thing, but technology is something we want to use to help us manage our ecosystem better, not something that we will use to try to keep the ecosystem from doing what it wants to. We want to augment those natural cycles, okay? And what you're trying to do in any farming system, anywhere in the world, is you're trying to match, if you're going to be long-term sustainable, you have to match the natural vegetation in terms of how it cycles water, how it cycles nutrients, how it captures sunlight and carbon dioxide from the air. And if you don't do that, if you allow your system to leak nutrients, for instance, out the bottom because you haven't gone down and kept that nutrient from going deep, or you let it go into a drain tile into the river. The Raccoon River at Des Moines, by the way, ran 22 parts per million nitrate nitrogen this spring. Legal drinking water is 10 parts per million. Okay? That's just really not acceptable. We can do better than that with cover crops and all these things that we're trying to use, but it's all part of a big picture. If you don't cycle those nutrients properly, you turn into a desert. The soils degrade to the point where you become a desert. Think of Israel, for instance. When they came there, there's a land of milk and honey. Have you ever been to Israel? It's rocks and sand. Okay? Because they turned it into that because of poor management. And so there's all these civilizations that we've only been here in the United States, and right in this area here, probably homesteaded slightly over 100 years ago. And we've degraded the ecosystem appreciably in the last 100 years. Okay, so one of the things we're trying to do is look at how can we better cycle things. I'm not so sure that we can do crop rotations without perennials and cycle, because you don't ever have a deep root system to suck things up. So we're gonna go out and look at some of those things. We talk here about different kinds of rotations. There are simple rotations, corn, soybean being one, wheat, fallow being one. These are simple because they're predictable in both sequence and interval. They're always so many years, wheat, corn, soybeans would be one. They're same sequence, same interval for that crop every time. So wheat always follows peas, for instance. Okay, so that gets to be, that's one of them. Then you can get more complex, and one we used to talk about at Redfield was to do something like wheat, corn, bean, corn, bean. So you're getting a more complex. Now half of your corn's into wheat stubble, half of your corn's into bean stubble. I sometimes call these my mother-in-law rotations. If your mother-in-law comes to visit you this time of year and you go through these fields out here, the corn planted into the bean stubble or pea stubble is nice and big and looks great, right? And the stuff in the wheat stubble is kind of dull. She comes in June, I show her those. If she comes in late August, most of the time we're going to go to the one that was planted into wheat stubble because it's going to have had the moisture. But what that does is it spreads your risk of wet and dry years. You got half your corn in a situation where it's going to do good in the wet year, and all of it's going to do okay most years. But when you get these dry cycles, and then you can get start getting more complex than that by adding, like Nathan said, sorghum instead of corn. In some of those things, you'll see some of that out there. We'll have sorghum corn stacked one behind the other because you break a lot of disease cycles there, but you still have kind of that look of corn in terms of high residue and how it uses water and what it's used for and what the market is. And then the one that everybody maybe attributes to us is a thing called a stacked rotation. And the stacked rotations are actually very similar to what Mother Nature does, because she'll have a new, if you go look at any spot on the prairie, you'll have a plant starts growing here, you'll stay here a few years and then it'll go away, and some other species will come into that position and it'll stay there a few years and it'll go away. And it really comes down to what happens with diseases and insects, especially in that it takes them a while. If the inoculum goes to very low levels, if we ask Emmanuel about the disease triangle, he's going to say, well, you need to have inoculum, a host, and the right weather, right? The disease triangle. So if you've had a very long break without a crop there, particular crop that gets a certain disease, then the first year, kind of independent of the weather, you're going to pretty well have low disease because you don't have the inoculum. Second year, you may have disease if you had the right weather the first year, let's say wet weather. Well, the probability of having two wet years in a row appears is pretty low. So it's not a bad trick to do that, to do two wheats, but the secret's having the low inoculum. If you do every other year, Emmanuel would tell you, you'll have a lot of inoculum hanging around because it'll last more than a year. The secret's having these really long breaks. It's not the stacking that's important, it's the long break that's important. So we started this with wheat, corn, broadleaf, which you'll see on the dry land, because very, very few people in the room remember this, but the old farm bill used to talk about base acres. A farmer would have a 50% wheat base. That means he was allowed to grow wheat on half of his acres. He couldn't grow any more wheat than that. And so when we came here, we knew that we needed to knock down the inoculum without doing tillage. So we needed a long break, but they weren't going to give up on 50% wheat. So we're better off with wheat, 2 years out of wheat than going wheat, something. So corn, soybean, or wheat, something are the worst rotation. And so we did spring wheat, winter wheat, corn, sunflower, or soybean because, again, the farm program would allow guys to grow flax or sunflower and call it wheat. See? In the old days, the farm program was just as stupid as it is now. and you can quote me on that. But anyway, that's how we started, and that principle still applies. And just a couple things on stacked rotations, and we'll go to the field. But the other things it does, and we got one on the irrigation you'll see, which is wheat, corn, soybean. Well, we get problems with insects, for instance, if we're consistent in sequence or interval. If you take corn rootworm as an example, and Ada's gone, so she can't correct me, but she won't. If you take corn rootworm, their normal habit is to for the beetle to feed on the silks of the corn, lay its eggs at the base of the plant. If you grow corn again the next year, you get problems. And that's why we have BT rootworm corn, which everybody grows, and now we're getting resistance to that. What happened in the Western Corn Belt, including Eastern South Dakota, they did corn bean, and said, we're going to take care of the corn rootworm by having corn bean. And we developed an extended dipous corn rootworm beetle. And what that means is that egg didn't hatch for 2 years. It waited an extra year for the corn to come back, okay? Because we were consistent in interval, always 2 years out. In reality, that female always laid eggs, which Mother Nature will do, It's like weed seeds. Some of them will hatch first year, some of them will hatch second year, maybe some of them will hatch third year. And so they just got in synchrony with what we were allowing to do. In the eastern Corn Belt, they developed the soybean variant, where the gravid or the pregnant female would fly to the soybean fields to lay her eggs, because corn always followed soybeans. So if you're consistent in sequence or interval, if the guys here always planted corn behind wheat, we will develop a corn rootworm that will lay her eggs in wheat stubble. So one of the things we're trying to do with something like a wheat, corn, corn, bean, is to be inconsistent in both sequence and interval. The other thing a stack allows us to do is to utilize long residual herbicide programs. Like right now, a lot of guys are just totally dependent on post-emerge programs. If you study Ecology 101, the hardest time to control an unwanted species in the ecosystem is once it's established. It's the least vulnerable is once that weed has started to grow and it's there, is when it's least vulnerable to control. Its most vulnerable period is before the seed is produced. So that's where we talk about sanitation, taking care of not letting that weeds go to seed and not digging up with high disturbance old weed seeds. and then with residual herbicide, you're taking care of it before it germinates. So with something like the first year corn and a corn on corn, we can use products like atrazine that we normally couldn't use in a lot of our soils or low organic matter situations because you fear carryover to some susceptible crop the next year. By putting two corns or a sorghum before corn, and that's one we use it a lot, you use a higher rate of atrazine, that's your weed control that year, and the second year go ahead and use your Roundup Ready. That takes a lot of pressure off the Roundup Ready in that, or the Roundup in terms of resistance, because we're not spraying the same product on the same weeds at the same time, year after year after year. That's really where you get resistance, okay? 1994, I predicted that Roundup was at a big Monsanto conference where I was a closing speaker. I predicted Roundup resistance before Monsanto said it was going to happen. Simply because Mother Nature will do that to you if you get predictable. Now, I also said it's not Monsanto's responsibility to protect it. It's the farmer's responsibility to do a better job of managing that technology. And that's really what we need to do, is manage our technology so we keep it. These companies aren't going to keep developing new stuff all the time for us. They'll just say, we're going to make more money someplace else. So anyway, that's I talk about all that stuff in here. That's the Reader's Digest condensed version of this. Let's go to the field. If you have no questions, we'll just go to the field.